So another free giveaway weekend has come and gone here, and I didn't get very many things. The most interesting was this cable box, this Motorola DCT700 cable box. I did get a few other things, like some power bricks and cables and stuff like that, but nothing especially interesting compared to this little guy. And I'm guessing that the reason that this showed up, and actually there were several of them, but this is the only one that I grabbed. I think the only reason that it showed up is because our local cable company is converting their entire video delivery platform from MPEG-4 to newest videoing encryption, not encryption, compression method, HEVC, which apparently will double the compression efficiency, so basically half the amount of data needed for the same video without killing quality. Who knew? Anyway, this box, as you can tell, is a very, very basic box. It just has the cable input, an RF modulated output, and then analog video and stereo audio. Nothing else. No HDMI, no component video, no Ethernet, no telephone jack, nothing like that. You may remember about a year ago, I did have another cable TV device that that was actually an Ethernet modem. Actually, no, did it have? Oh yeah, it did have Ethernet, USB, and voice on it, so you could plug just a standard old telephone onto it. But no video component on that one. This is pretty much the opposite. This is video with no other data solutions on it. So now, with that one screw out of there, I'm going to go digging for other screws. I'm going to assume, no, there isn't under that foot. Okay, put under that foot. No. No. Okay. Is it just clips from here on? How does you get into this thing? Aha, there it is. I thought it was just clips in that one screw, but no. Okay, we are in. Let's see what we got here. Ooh, infinite numbers of bypass capacitors on this side. Wow, that is a lot. And down here we have an RF can, which is that on the input side or the output side? Let's find out. That is probably the modulator for the output, I'm guessing. And then this will be, tuning, maybe? Anyway, more RF stuff, more shielded RF stuff, obviously. Oh, and we have a little memory backup battery. Okay. Cool. So, yeah, I wasn't expecting this to be a lot of commodity components, but there is some interesting stuff going on in here. Okay, so start by the DC input jack. We have a diode, which is going to be polarity protection. Handful of capacitors, inductors, another inductor, another diode. Another fairly big diode. So I'm guessing that there is some sort of active power supply stuff happening in here. Let me get a bit closer and see if I can find the switching regulator. So because these surface mount devices are such a pain in the ass to try and find data sheets for, I'm just going to do this a little bit more empirically. The diodes, the three big diodes I could find, those are Schottky diodes. This one is another one down there. This is a BJT, a power transistor. These two guys are both op amps. So I don't think they are part of the power supply circuit, but this little 8-pin and 6-pin, and then the same two chips there, probably are, and they've got a big diode associated with them. Not quite sure what that guy's doing. Maybe it's part of a series regulator taking one of these other voltages. I don't know. Anyway, the voltages that we can find on here. There's the 12 volts coming in. This one is a 5-volt power supply, so that's one of the step-downs. That is also 5 volts, and judging by the tracks, those two are in parallel. this next one is 1.3 volts. Okay, that's something you could definitely buck down to. That's also 1.3 volts. And this capacitor over here is negative 3.3. Well, wait, I'm across it the wrong way. It's 3.3 volts. That's also 5 volts. Okay. So we got a few different voltages happening on here. 3.3 is probably a logic voltage. The 1.3, I'm not quite sure. 5 volts will be the other one that's powering various logic chips and things in here. So what other fun can we see on here? There's 1, 2, 3 crystals. One of those is probably going to be clocking some kind of a microcontroller. The other ones may be being used as frequency references for the RF stuff going on in here. And over here, we've got a couple of adjustments. So probably gain, I'm guessing. And what is that chip there? MCBC375. I wonder if that's findable.
Oh yeah, I guess it makes sense that Motorola will be using their own chips in it. This is an RF modulator chip. Well, very standard kind of a thing used all over the place. Channel 3 and channel 4 is the standard VHF channels that if you've got an old school NTSC television, that is typically what any device that connected to it before the advent of baseband connections on your TVs, that's what it would be. And there's how it would be set up. Pin 1 would be your channel select, either 3 or 4. Pin 4 will be a 4 meg crystal input. So I'm going to guess that crystal beside it is a 4 meg. Let's take a look.
If we can get some of this schmoo out of the way to actually see the markings on the thing. Okay, that worked better than expected. Yeah, 4 megahertz crystal. Cool, so that confirms that my datasheet finding was at least good for that chip. So that means this is the output, which I guess makes sense because here's the other two baseband outputs, and those would be the same lines that are going into this thing for audio and video, which would mean that is probably a test point to break off the analog audio and video. And those three transistors there are likely buffering the output so that if you short these, it doesn't kill the input to this guy. That would be my guess anyway. So initially I had speculated that would be the modulator and this would be the demodulation, but I think I've got it backwards. With that being input connector, that means this will be receiving the RF signal off the cable TV plant, and this will be doing the video processing, I'm guessing now, because over here we have the modulator already. Let's see what's under can number one. We find another can, and looks like some input protection. There's some capacitors and looks like a couple of diodes across there, probably just protecting that input. Let's see what's underneath this Alps can. These Alps I recognize as a fairly prominent manufacturer. So we'll see what this little submodule is. Oh, RF goodness. Plenty of inductors doing probably filtering and other, you know, tuned resonant stuff. We have a 4-point, what are you? 4-point code number. So 4-ish megahertz probably. Crystal oscillator in there. And then this looks like it's plugged onto something. Can we just lift it off? Would it be that easy? No, of course not. It's probably soldered down. I'm not seeing any screws or anything, so yeah, these RF cans tend to be soldered down. And opposite it, there is another lid, and that one is soldered on. I'm going to guess that there is some active componentry under there. We'll save that for a minute and keep looking at the things that we can get to easily. So just outside of that receiving RF can, we have this guy here, which judging by its number, TP something something, and it has 5 pins on it. So that is probably an isolation transformer. And then we have this interesting looking little chip here. which obviously is dissipating some power based on those two huge pads there. LA7784. And that has that memory backup battery right beside it.
Oh yeah, now we got something going on here. LA7784 is a down converter IC for digital cable TV. Accepts RF inputs between 50 and 150 megahertz and supports DOCSIS and EuroDOCSIS, which is DOCSIS being standard used in North America for cable. Normally that's used for cable internet and stuff. But I guess since they're using this for digital video, that's probably reasonable as well. It has built-in RF mixer. It has attenuation controls. It has drivers for SAW filters. It is AGC amplifier and an IF driver. Oh, those aren't power pins or, well, they might be dissipating heat, but they are just the ground pins. Okay. And yeah, there are a fair number of grounds on here, which makes sense. When you're playing with RF, you want to have lots and lots of ground just to try and keep things tamed and separated and not getting where they're not supposed to be. Okay, that's a cool, busy little circuit. Nifty.
All right, so far we've more or less established that the signal flow is coming in here, getting filtered and possibly amplified, depending on what's underneath there. Isolation transformer. Down converter, RF conversion there. Still not quite sure what that backup battery is powering. That crystal may actually be the reference for this guy. Next mystery, what's underneath can number two? Oh wow, I like it when those aren't, oh wow. Yeah, I like it when those aren't welded down, but wow, here is where all the digital signal processing is happening. I can see a Samsung on that one. I can see Motorola on there. Is that NXP chip? I can't see the whole part number because of this can here. So one of these guys is going to be a digital signal processor. One's going to be probably a microprocessor or a microcontroller. And then some signal forming stuff. What have we got over here? ST Micro and... I'm going to see if I can find some of these part numbers. Hang on.
So that Samsung chip is 128 megs of DDR SRAM, SDRAM. Didn't expect that. But I suppose there needs to be some memory if you got a microprocessor in there, sure.
There, that'll make it easier to read that next chip. NXP64462-11.
My Googling is not finding me this chip. It's pretty clearly a processor. It's finding a few different sellers that are need you to log in and stuff like that to tell you even what it is. The closest I've come is this result, which may be correct, and it seems right. 32-bit ARM Cortex, possibly. I don't know. Anyway, it's clearly a microcontroller or microprocessor of some sort.
And I've also dug around, and this Motorola chip, I can't find that anywhere either. So, other than this being a microcontroller, a microprocessor, that being memory, that don't know. Maybe that's our DSP? I don't know. And then these two guys here are also both memory.
One of them is 32 megabit flash, and the other one is a 2 megabit static RAM.
So that's interesting. This is all computer in here, unless that's a signal processor, but I don't know. It is a Motorola part number, but I can't find it anywhere. So all that leaves is, well, there's some just basic 74 series logic over here and another op amp. So I'm guessing that any magic is going to be happening under there. That's going to be a royal pain in the butt to remove. But remove it I shall. There we go. Now it's cooperating. Just needed a little bit of the old ultraviolet. Well, after all that, there's nothing but a few capacitors under there. It's just shielding. So is the interesting bit underneath there then? How do I get that out? Aha! There. That took some violence, but I got it out. Your secrets will be revealed. Wow. What a lot of capacitors. But I guess that makes sense because they would pair with all the inductors on the other side to create filters and things. And then we have this single lonely chip in here. And it is Alps branded, as was the can that it was hiding in. Alps 511. Yeah, okay, let's see if I can find out what that is. Oh, after all that violence and abuse that I had to put this board through to get at it, I could not find that chip anywhere. Nor could I find any of the numbers that are on the lid of the can that was hiding it. The only stuff that I could find with Alps is the switches and potentiometers that they manufacture these days. Maybe they're not even in this business anymore. Anyway, I learned some things about this. Found some that it's mostly digital processing after it gets demodulated. Other than that, I don't know what else to say about this thing. The power supply section looks neat. Compact little box, fairly solid. I wouldn't expect anything shoddy from Motorola. Their products, especially their RF products, have always been good stuff, so I guess I shouldn't be surprised that this thing is fairly solidly built. And yeah, I don't know what else to say about it. Kind of wish I could have found more information on a few more of these chips, especially the ones that are doing the magic. But I'm going to guess that most of it is happening inside that microprocessor or microcontroller or whatever it is in the digital domain. Anyway, thanks for coming along on this little journey. I appreciate it as always. Questions and comments down below. Oh, talk to you later. Oh, and I bet somebody is wondering about that beer. Today I've been drinking Mountjoy Irish Stout from Stone Angel Brewing in Winnipeg. Nice traditional Irish stout.